Right. Trying to keep my throat. Probably talked too much this morning.
C'est surtout pour les sessions en intro à la biologie. C'est Nabil qui va présenter Dr. Mallory, mais juste pour être clair, vous avez trois questions à choix multiples et vous répondez directement à la feuille. Les réponses vont être sur les diapositives de Dr. Mallory. Si vous avez des questions, s'il y a de quoi qui n'est pas clair, vous pouvez poser une question à la fin ou me poser une question avant de partir. Okay? S'il y a de quoi qui n'est pas 100% clair, n'oubliez pas de mettre votre nom là-dessus.
Bonjour tout le monde, good afternoon. Je vais présenter le Dr. Mallory. Je vais faire présentation en français et suite présentation en anglais. Alors, le docteur Mark Mallory a complété ses études de premier cycle à l'Université Queen's à Kingston, Ontario, et une maîtrise en doctorat et doctorat à l'Université Carleton, Ottawa. Il a débuté sa carrière en tant que biologiste avec le Service canadien de la faune, où il a étudié les effets de la pluie acide sur divers réseaux tropiques en Ontario. En 1999, lui et sa famille ont déménagé à Iqaluit, au nord. Là, il a passé plus que 10 ans, toujours avec le Service canadien de la faune, et il a étudié l'écologie des oiseaux nicheurs à travers de l'Arctique. Il faut noter que Marc a un coup de foudre pour l'Arctique. Il aime beaucoup la région. En 2011, Dr. Mallory a quitté la fonction publique pour devenir professeur de biologie à l'Université Acadia, là où il occupe présentement un chaire de recherche du Canada sur les écosystèmes des zones humides côtières. Avec ses collaborateurs et ses étudiants, la recherche de Marc touche à plusieurs disciplines reliées à l'écologie des côtes, de l'Arctique et ici en maritime, et incluant l'écologie du comportement et la population environnementale, changement climatique, et il a souvent intégré les connaissances autochtones dans ses recherches. La conférence de Marc aujourd'hui porte sur les recherches effectuées dans son labo et spécifiquement comment nous pouvons utiliser des oiseaux de mer pour identifier des habitats marins, importants, et aussi comment ces oiseaux affectent les écosystèmes terrestres au site de nidification. Good afternoon. Dr. Mallory conducted his undergraduate studies at Queen's University, Kingston, Ontario, and his MSc and PhD at Carleton University, Ottawa, Ontario. He spent the first 15 field seasons of his professional career studying the effect of acid rain on aquatic food webs in central Ontario with the Canadian Wildlife Service. In 1999, he moved with his family to Iqaluit, Nunavut, where he spent 12 years as a habitat and seabird biologist, still with the Canadian Wildlife Service, working across the magnificent Canadian Arctic. In 2011, Dr. Mallory left the government to start work at Acadia University as the Canada Research Chair, Tier 2, in coastal wetland ecosystems, where he studied ecology and environmental stressors on Arctic and maritime conditions. With his collaborators, he conducted research in a variety of disciplines, including behavioral ecology, environmental pollution, climate change, and local ecological knowledge. In his presentation today, he will discuss some of the work undertaken in his lab to look at how we can use seabirds to identify important marine habitats and how seabirds using those habitats return to breeding colonies and affect the terrestrial environment near their rest. Here's Dr. Mallory.
Thank you. After that introduction, I feel really old. It's hard to believe I look barely a day over 35. Okay, we'll try this here. Bonjour, je m'appelle Marc Mallory et je suis professeur à l'Université Acadia. Malheureusement, je suis unilingue et je ne peux donc pas faire cette présentation en français. Cependant, comme mon épouse acadienne me le rappelle, mes talents sont limités, mais j'ai fait un excellent choix avec une partenaire bilingue et talentueuse. Et elle a traduit la présentation pour moi. J'espère que ça marche. And that's about the most I'm going to be able to do in French. Sorry, just a sec here. Let's get this going forward. There we go. So hopefully, can everybody hear me fine if I speak away from the microphone? Okay. I have two presentations going because I was afraid that I might not be able to say exactly what I wanted to say if I just followed the French one. So the French one's on your screen while I'm looking at some English here. So hopefully this all works out. So thank you very much for the invitation. I'm quite honored to be here. It's a beautiful campus. Sean had me out around some of the campus. It's lovely, and I definitely intend on being back. And actually, Sean and I are starting up some work together, or actually continuing. I guess we started last year with co-supervising a student. So I'm really happy to be down in this part of Nova Scotia. So thank you. Today's talk is kind of called Looking Out and Looking In, Connections Between Colonial Seabirds, Contaminants, and Marine Protection. Now, there were a couple other talk titles that I could have gone with, the top 10 reasons to hire undergraduates, things I'll do to get on the Mountain Equipment Co-op catalog, and things I'll do to get on Arctic cruise ships. However, I kind of thought after Sean told me that probably the first title was more appropriate, so we'll go with that. But we do try to have a bit of fun when we're out there working. Now, what we do at the lab is quite diverse. No one can accuse me of being a really focused scientist. I'm a little bit all over the map. So over the next 3.5 hours, we'll go in detail over each. No, I'm just kidding. Really, most of my work can be summarized fairly simply in that I look at, the introduction said, interactions between past or current anthropogenic activities, so human activities, and aquatic ecosystems. And I'm looking at the interaction between what people do to the environment and aquatic ecosystems, and generally I measure that by looking at birds. So if you think about it, a lot of my work revolves around looking at seabird movement and behavior, what seabirds are doing out in the ocean, what seabirds are doing back at land, and how that informs us on all of this marine habitat, this open water area, or what's going on back at the land behind us. A lot of that has to do with important areas out in the water, and a lot of that has to do with contaminants back on land. I've been very lucky to be able to study the Canadian Arctic and to study seabirds for about 20 years. As was stated, I worked for Environment Canada for much of that time. I was working in the Arctic, so I got to do a lot of work on contaminants. For those who might not be able to see the screen, on the bottom left, that's me coming up the cliff with these cases. There's eggs, so I've gone down the cliff to get eggs, which now for 45 years we've been collecting in the Canadian High Arctic and monitoring contaminants. And on the right, that's me at Coates Island, where we're doing population monitoring and banding of thick-billed murres. The site on the left at Prince Leopold Island is probably, in the Arctic for sure, it's Canada's best long-term contaminant monitoring site for any species. 45 years at the same site with the same species. No one has a better record than that. On the right, that's probably Canada's best seabird climate change monitoring site that Tony Gaston started in 1982. I've been lucky enough to collaborate with these and sort of kind of take over, force myself in to take over Prince Leopold Island, but it was started by people before me. Certainly, I didn't start those programs. The talk outline today, it's kind of broken down into two parts, not quite equal. The first part, we're going to talk about determining marine habitat. So if you think of standing in a seabird colony, and think of it, you're at the edge of the colony, here's the colony. And the first part, we're going to talk about looking out at the water. If you just go to the shore here, you're looking out at the water, and we're trying to figure out what are the important places out in the water for those seabirds. And then, never turn your back on an audience if you're speaking, but then if you think the second half, we're turning around, we're looking back at the colony, at what the birds are doing back at the colony when they come back. Typically when they're either on their eggs or feeding their young. So that's kind of how I've broken it up. Out in the water, the first part, back at the colony, the second. Now, this is where our lab works. We're covering quite a bit of eastern Canada. In the top left part of the graph, this is up in Nunavut, the high Arctic. So the Devon Island is this one that sort of looks like a shoe with a red dot and then two black dots. So that's up in the high Arctic at about 76 degrees north. Then we do some work as we move down out of the Arctic in northern Hudson Bay and off of Baffin Island. And then down, we've been working off of Labrador, down in Nova Scotia, and the top right has an inset of the places that the lab's worked since 2011 in Nova Scotia.
a little bit off of Newfoundland, and then through collaborators, I've been able to go over and do some work in Iceland, off of Portugal, and then I've got a grad student who's also working down in South Africa. The differences between the colors, the blacks are sites where we've either built a research station or we use a long-term research station. The red sites are places where I put a student in with another researcher or we just go for a one-year project. Now, put that back down. I note that while some of the photos in the talk hopefully make this work look kind of glamorous, it is a beautiful place to work. We have a lab motto, and that is safety is our fourth priority. So it takes a certain type of person to work in the Arctic and to work at seabird colonies. It's not for everybody. So we're fairly choosy on who we bring in. Polar bears in the Arctic, polar bears, if you want to see a polar bear, go to a seabird colony in the summer. Because the birds are there, they smell, the bears are looking for food, they come in. So we get a lot of polar bears. This is Mark and Shanti with one bear that came in on the bottom. That's another bear coming in on Mark. Some people may ask why I'm taking a picture and Shanti's got the gun, but she's looking back at me. The fact of the matter is, I really didn't like those two students very much. So it kind of didn't matter what happened. No, I'm kidding. There's another one or two students on the side with guns, and I just thought that was a nice photo with Shanti. Most of those bears, we've never had to shoot a bear yet, and we've never had a bear attack any of us. We have had bears do a bunch of damage to our sites, though. But it's not for everybody. Not everybody under that sort of pressure operates exactly as you'd like, so we're pretty choosy who we take on. Most of this talk is going to focus on colonial seabirds. Why is this? Well, there's greater than 50 million of these creatures in the Canadian Arctic. If you include the waters of Greenland and Baffin Bay, that section between Greenland and Canada, of course, the birds know no international boundaries, so they're flying across from Canada or from Greenland to feed in that area. So there's greater than 50 million of these all in that area. We have legal responsibilities because we've signed international agreements. We've got legal responsibilities to protect these populations. I think we have a moral responsibility as one of the few creatures on the planet that can change habitats and willfully change habitat to the detriment of another species. But also because colonial seabirds are really excellent biomonitors and bioindicators of the health of the environment. So by biomonitors, we can go to a seabird colony, and as I alluded to a moment ago, we can go and check the same species through time, say check their eggs, and track through time what's going on in the environment. As a bioindicator, we now know we've been doing this long enough that there's thresholds for, say, reproductive success or egg size or number of eggs laid, where we know if it's above a certain number, then it's going to be a good year, and that means the breeding environment is good. If it's below a certain measure, then it means something's wrong in the marine environment that year. So they're a good bioindicator and they're a good biomonitor. So what are colonial seabirds? I've already said this term a bunch of times. What are these colonial seabirds? Well, we're going to go with a simple definition here, and apologies to those bird purists in the crowd who might differ with this, but really all we're looking for are birds that are living near the ocean, in this case in large groups. So this is a breeding ledge of thick-billed murres. You can see there's an egg right there. These guys are all on eggs, so for those who are looking online, all of the birds that are pointed with their chests against the rock, and you can see them all lined up together, they're all on eggs. They don't build a nest. The egg is just laid on the rock. So this is a fairly large breeding ledge. But we've got birds, and it's about 300 meters up in the air, so we're almost 1,000 feet climbed down by rope to get to this spot. So we've got birds living near the ocean, and we've got birds that are feeding in the ocean. So that's really our definitions. They're living near the ocean, and they're feeding in the ocean. But of course, they're colonial, so they're living in a large group, and in the Arctic, this is typically on an island or on a cliff, because those are the two places that mammalian predators, polar bears or Arctic foxes, can't get. There's nothing they can really do about avian predators like gulls or falcons. They can get anywhere that they can fly. But by nesting on islands and by nesting on cliffs, it reduces the chance that mammalian predators can get to them. So that's where most of these colonies are. If we look at the Canadian Arctic then, unfortunately, that map doesn't come out very well with the way the light is, but this is Nunavut, looking at Nunavut. Hudson Bay is at the bottom, and we're looking up to the high Arctic, to the top of Ellesmere Island. You can almost draw a line down the center of the Canadian Arctic, and in the western Canadian Arctic, there's very few bird colonies. In the eastern Canadian Arctic, that's where we've got most of them. The really big colonies, so well over 10,000 pairs, anywhere from 30,000 to 400,000 pairs of birds are those red dots.
less than 10,000 pairs, but still a pretty good colony, say 1,000 pairs or more, is the green dots. That big area where you see that big, on the top left, that area where there's no colonies, we think that's for two reasons. One is it's very flat, so there's no places for cliff nesting birds to nest. But secondarily, that's one of the places where the ice, the sea ice, goes out latest in the year. And so the birds are already under a short time window to be able to get up with open water to feed in, because of course, that's one of our definitions, they have to be able to feed in the ocean. So they've got to have the ice move out to be able to feed. The window, the timing there, by the time that ice moves out, there's just not enough time for the birds to nest, lay eggs, rear the chicks, and have the chicks leave before the ice comes in and would just kill them. So it's mostly in the eastern Arctic that we're talking about. That's where we do most of our work. And the species we're talking about are these here. As we move from the top left, that's the thick-billed murre. It looks a lot like a penguin, but it can also fly, so it's cooler than penguins. In the top center is the black guillemot, and we get those actually down around here, all the way up to the high Arctic. The northern fulmar is the top right. Then as we come down to the center, this is the ivory gull, the Arctic tern, Ross's gull, Sabine's gull, black-legged kittiwake, and the dovekie, or little auk. For people who are really into birds, the dovekie, there's actually probably less than 100 that breed in Canada, but there's 30 million that breed on the West Greenland coast and come into Canada to feed, and then they all come down, migrate through Canadian waters and winter in Canada. So we've got a huge responsibility for dovekies, we just don't have a lot that actually breed right in Canada. So that's an introduction to the birds and the types of places we find them. So now on to the topics that we do a lot of research on. So what do we need to do to determine key marine habitats? So one of the big questions I've got is, if we've got this colony, I want to know what marine area out there sustains this colony. Getting a bit of feedback here. Because there's lots of cliffs that they could be nesting on, but they're choosing this cliff. Presumably that's because wherever they're feeding out there, there's good food that allows them to stay here. So one of the first questions we've got at the colony is, where do these birds go? If you went out here and you stand at the edge of campus and you've got a gull or some sort of marine bird there, you can watch it for a ways, and then if you have binoculars, you can watch it even farther, but eventually you just can't see it anymore. You don't know where that bird goes. And until very recently, that's been the situation for seabirds biologists for centuries, is that they haven't been able to tell, when they're at a colony, where the birds from that colony are going out to feed. They can talk to fishermen and sailors, and the sailors will say, oh, when we came within so many leagues of shore, we started to see lots of whatever species you're interested in. But they can't tell you for sure that species, those birds they saw, were from this colony. So the connection between the colony and the birds that we see offshore, we've never really been able to tell. So we want to know where these birds go. But importantly, we want to be a little bit more precise in that. We want to know how far away they go from the colony. We want to know, do they always go to the same place, or might they change positions through the year, and especially in the Arctic, as the ice melts out, does this change where the birds go as the ice melts out, as you might expect? So does sea ice influence where they change? Some birds we know actively like feeding around the ice, and other birds avoid the ice. And finally, how might industrial activity influence this? Because the Arctic, with sea ice changing with climate change issues now, sea ice becoming more unpredictable, and more interest in shipping through the Arctic, we're at the stage now where if we can identify these key sites before we get lots of shipping there, we might be able to get protection in place, seasonal protection at least, that will help conserve our Arctic bird populations before lots of ships or industrial accidents happen. So, when seabirds move out of sight, as I said, for years and years and years, it's been very difficult. But the best you could do is have someone down below the colony in a boat, and you watch a bird go, and the person follows that in the boat. And they do that for a long ways, and they might be going down a fjord, or they might be going out into the open ocean, then it gets too rough, etc. But that's really all we've been able to do until about the last 30 years, certainly the last 20 years, where we've got miniaturized telemetry options, and that's completely revolutionized how we do this. So, in this image here, you can see we've got three types of telemetry that we use typically. Satellite transmitters, geolocators, and GPS loggers. The top image here is an ivory gull with a satellite transmitter on its back. This fulmar has a satellite transmitter. This has a solar panel on it that allows it to recharge. This one has a battery-powered one, so it's actually under its feathers, but there's an antennae you can just barely see there.
Here's a geolocator on the leg of this Jaeger. There's a geolocator on my finger and a geolocator here. And this is a GPS pack on the back of a kittiwake. Down the bottom image is a kittiwake with a GPS pack. You can see the sizes of these have changed. When I started doing this work, the satellite transmitters were like a small laptop you put on the back, about the only thing you could track was an albatross or maybe a really big goose. Now they're down to 2 grams, which is incredible. 2 grams, that's like 2 dimes mass. It's crazy. Geolocators are even smaller. They can get down to about 1 gram, and the GPS units are down to less than 5 grams now, which is great. Can go on very small birds. So we can put these units down in birds 50 to 60 grams now. Other types of technology, we can go even smaller, like VHF technology, but it doesn't allow us to give precise positions. And the satellite transmitters are accurate to about a kilometer, maybe half a kilometer with good data, but they cost about $4,000 a piece. So it's $20,000 to track 5 birds. So you have to be careful, choose your birds well. The geolocators are only accurate to about 150 kilometers, so they're really good for tracking long-distance migrations if we want to know where the bird goes and it's traveling a long ways, but they're no good for short local stuff. But they're quite a bit cheaper. They're about $400 or $500 a piece. And then the GPS trackers are the most accurate. They're just like a GPS you would have in your phone or that you would take out with you in the woods. They're accurate to a few meters. You know, I could tell which side of the stage the bird was on. And they're now down to about $2,000, $2,500. So they're a compromise between the two. Importantly, for all of these things, you have to catch the bird to be able to do this. Remember our lab motto, safety is our fourth priority. So this is Paul and Uli going out to get a kittiwake. In the image in the right there, Uli's got a kittiwake in the bag here, and he's passing an egg back to Paul on that pole for the contaminants monitoring. You can see here, this is like a stack of kitchen plates that we're climbing on. It's just terrible stuff to climb on. So again, it takes a certain type of either fortitude or stupidity to go do this work. And unfortunately, I've had a lot of stupid students. We're really looking at 2 types of information that we can gather from this telemetry work. We're either looking for data that gives us long-term, year-round movements, and so any of those types of tracking units will work for that, but particularly satellite transmitters and geolocators are really designed for long-term tracking, so we can track birds from the Arctic to know they go anywhere on the planet. Or we can do short-term stuff where we're particularly interested in typically that's done during the feeding season, although Sean and I were just talking about a winter project, actually, I think we'll try and start this year here at St. Anne. But typically it's done during the breeding season where the birds are coming back to their colony and we want to know how far they're going and where they're going around the colony. So I'm first going to talk about the long-term year-round type of tracking. And we'll give some studies, I'll sort of whip through a few studies that we've done on this just to give an example of the type of stuff we get. So in the case here, this is the thick-billed murre, and we did a bunch of work here with geolocators by attaching geolocators to the leg bands of the thick-billed murres. And we did this at several colonies in Nunavut, and what we were able to find was that the colonies tend to have different wintering locations, so not only are the birds breeding at different colonies, but they winter in different areas in the ocean. This became really important, for example, with the situation, I think it was just before Christmas, with that oil spill off in Newfoundland. With some of the work, this is just some of the early work, we've got lots more data now, but you can see there's a group that winter here, out here. Some of the work now tells us that we can say, if we know where an oil spill is, we can now have a pretty good guess as to which colony is most likely to be affected, and therefore we can divert our plans to make sure we get to that colony the next year to check, in fact, if there were negative impacts from that oil spill, and if so, how bad it was. So we know there's birds wintering in different areas that are related to their colonies. We also, it's a very collaborative community, the Circumpolar Arctic Seabird Group. So back in International Polar Year in 2007-2008, our colleagues across Europe also deployed these tags at the thick-billed murre colonies, everywhere that you see a yellow star in the bottom right image. So we did it here in Canada, and then Greenland, and through Iceland, and over through Europe. And this is an image of where those birds were in the winter. And you can see right away that the majority of the North Atlantic population of thick-billed murres winters off in Newfoundland and Labrador. Right? So we've got a huge responsibility for this species in the winter for all of the North Atlantic. And also Greenland as well. But we get a huge movement of all these birds from Europe and all the way over to Russia, all wintering off of Canada. Contrast that with the black-legged kittiwake. Now, it's very difficult to get black-legged kittiwakes in Canada, so you can see there's only one colony in Canada that we were able to get to and tag them. They're really tough to get in our Arctic, but they're very easy to get in Europe because kittiwakes will nest on the roofs of buildings and wharves and that. So there's lots of data from Europe. Nonetheless, unlike the murre, we could figure out right away that some kittiwakes winter in Europe, and a lot of the kittiwakes winter just like the murres off of Newfoundland and Labrador. So you can start to see right away that this area off of Newfoundland and Labrador is really important in the winter for seabirds, which we knew, but we start to get really hard numbers on how many are there and where they're coming from to get there. Right, so this area becomes quite important. And again, this was a really nice circumpolar collaboration between Europe, Iceland, the Danes, Greenland, and ourselves. Some work that we've done right at Acadia with some of the students. This was Nora Spencer's master's thesis. She was tracking ivory gulls. This is an endangered species. And the ivory gull, we're able to show, spends its entire year around ice. So it breeds up here in the red area, winters, moves down, and then winters in this pale blue area. That pale blue area we now know, because of some tracking that was done by our colleagues in Norway and in Greenland, the lion's share, most of the world's population of ivory gulls, winters in that pale blue area, which is right where the edge of the pack ice forms each year in the winter between Greenland and Labrador. Also an area where industrial activity is looking to do year-round ice breaking, or at least move ships through year-round, so in the winter they might have to break ice there to get ships in and out for industrial activity in Nunavut. So this information, we had no intention on this being part of environmental assessment, but it's now become very important for environmental assessment for some new industrial activity in Nunavut because there's an endangered species where ice breaking may affect its winter habitat. So that clearly is a key offshore site that we've identified through this tracking work. Here's Mark Mofty, who was working on Ross's gulls. That's a threatened species in Canada. It's the rarest breeding seabird in North America. We only know about 10 nests each year. Five of those are at one of the field sites we built, mostly to study the species. Unfortunately, again, you can't see in that image there. It's a little bit whited out. I'll have to remember that to change the type of background. But for this species, almost all of the world population, effectively like 99% of the world population, breeds in Siberia and winters in the Bering Sea between Russia and Alaska. So we fully expected ours to just be a few straggler birds that headed over to join those in the Bering Sea. They did the exact opposite. They went right down where the kittiwakes and the murres are, and they winter off of Newfoundland and Labrador. So again, yet more proof that this area off of Newfoundland and Labrador is critical in the winter for marine birds. And Shanti Davis worked on Sabine's gulls, and an interesting finding here, lots of interesting findings, but two key things I'll point out. First, our colony is up there where the Black Star is. We've got birds that were migrating both to the Atlantic and the Pacific Ocean, so we're right on the bridge where we think after the last glaciation, Sabine's gulls that were wintering in or living in those two areas slowly immigrated and slowly moved up and colonized areas where the ice had now moved off, and they met somewhere around our area, and there's still this residual behavior where they're going back to the different sites. So that was kind of neat. And I also point out, if you look off of British Columbia, there's a key staging area just off of British Columbia where it overlays very nicely from some tracking work on terns that was done in Alaska and a couple other species, all there. That happens to be right where we're talking about putting new or expanding pipeline, oil pipeline activity coming out, and right where we're talking about expanding shipping to deal with those pipelines is in this key area where all these Arctic birds stop to fatten up before they either continue on south or they continue on north. So again, this is more proof that this tracking, you don't have to track a lot of birds to get some really important information you didn't really have previously. And here's a few examples of other species, dovekies, fulmars, and common eiders. And we've done herring gulls and jaegers and a bunch of other species. So we're starting to get a really nice compilation now of identifying key sites for these different species at sea that they use year-round in their travels. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch gears back. So that talks a little bit about using geolocators and satellite transmitters to look at the long-distance movements of these birds and particularly identifying some important areas elsewhere in Canada or in other countries that are critical to maintain our populations in Canada. So I'm going to switch gears now and talk about the short-term local movements of the birds. And this really is more for the breeding season and starting to think about things like shipping around seabird colonies and oil spills, that type of business. So I'll go back to that work that Nora did. When we took some of the data from Nora's work, this green line you see is about a 50-kilometer distance. And so what, by tracking the ivory gulls from Seymour Island, we could see they were flying out about 50 kilometers and would spend several hours out that way and then come back. The closest open waters, if you move to the east and got over here into Penny Strait, between these islands, the Grinnell Peninsula and Bathurst Island, that's the closest open water, 85 to 100 kilometers away, and the birds aren't going there at all. And in fact, when you check the ice where the birds were going, it is solid ice. It's not broken up. At this time of year, there's no cracks, there's no leads. It's solid ice. So the question is, well, what the heck are they feeding on? The only thing those birds can be feeding on is they're finding high ice, they're looking for polar bears, and they follow polar bears, and once they find a bear and it kills something, they come in and they scavenge what the bear leaves behind. So it shows the close ties between ivory gulls and polar bears and their reliance of this colony on bears out hunting on the ice in this area to persist. But they're going 50 kilometers away to find their food and come back. Here we've got a thick-billed murre, and this is Prince Leopold Island, so we're right in the Northwest Passage now. That red line is 100 kilometers, and the conventional thought was that most thick-billed murres forage within about 100 kilometers of their colony. This particular year, we put the GPS trackers on in this case. You could see some of them were actually flying down to Croker Bay, almost 200 kilometers away, and you don't see it in this image very well, but there's still lots of foraging within 100 kilometers, but a little bit farther than we were thinking. And then we go to something like the northern fulmar that we did with those satellite transmitters, and you can see here that the fulmar colony is at Cape Vera, but the birds are flying all the way over to Greenland, up the coast of Greenland to feed around here in the North Water Polynya, and then flying back, or flying all the way south down to Bylot Island and back. It's 500 kilometers just one way if you go direct flight. So these birds are flying 1,500 or 2,000 kilometers in a trip to find food. Takes them about 4 or 5 days. Their mate stays in the nest, doesn't move, doesn't get off the egg, doesn't feed, doesn't drink anything. It sits on the egg for 4 or 5 days straight. Then its mate comes back and they switch, and its mate goes out and does the same thing. So tremendous distances, and shows how important some of these areas are very far from the colony, depending on the species. Now, I realize it's easy to say, you know, 50, 100, 500 kilometers, so to try and put this in some context for people here, if we had ivory gulls nesting on the roof of this building, and I told you, you need to go out and you need to find where the key marine area is that's supporting these ivory gulls up here, you'd be searching in an area about that big, down across the south shore, a good chunk of the way over towards Grand Manan Island, and up, moving up towards Kentville. If we had thick-billed murres nesting on the side of the building, you'd have a 100-kilometer, or maybe a little more, but a 100-kilometer radius. So now you have to go all the way over to Maine and New Brunswick. You're out across the other side of Nova Scotia, much farther down to the south, and most of the way up to the Minas Basin. So this is a huge area to try and search to find where it is. And then it gets ridiculous if we talk fulmars. You're all the way to the St. Lawrence River. You're out past Sable Island. You're all the way up to Cape Breton, and you're well down past Cape Cod. The fulmars, if they're nesting on the building, that's how far they can be flying to feed. Okay, so it's a tremendously huge area. So you can appreciate now, when I'm not kidding when I say it was effectively impossible to do this before we had this telemetry equipment. It's impossible to figure out. It's a needle in a haystack trying to find where they're going. So this miniature telemetry equipment has really revolutionized what we're able to do. So we started getting some of these results, as you saw in some of those papers there. This was a study we did working with, led by Tony Gaston, who's retired now. But the upper left is work at the Coates Island colony. And this is a small murre colony of about 30,000 pairs. So, you know, probably about 70, if you include non-breeders, probably about 70 or 80,000 birds at the colony in the summer, not too big. And flying about 30 kilometers away. Most of the foraging there is about 30 kilometers out from the colony. On the right is the Digg Sound colony, which is 400,000 pairs. So you've got about 1 million birds around there in the summer. And that distance is about 100 kilometers out. And there's certain theories, there's foraging theories, central place foraging theory, that has this sort of elaborate formula for looking at how large a colony is and how far away the birds should be feeding, how that might change through the year, all sorts of stuff. So it's a theoretical formula that can be applied to seabird colonies for what are called central place foragers. That is, they have to keep coming back to the same spot because they're coming back to their nest. So there's going to be some limits on how far away they can go. So we applied this to, we got these data on these distances they were flying of colonies of different size. We started to make some models. And we put together this paper modeling foraging ranges of breeding colonies in the eastern Canadian Arctic with this idea of being able to say something about what are important areas for shipping. And we made this map, and we provided this map, it's in the paper, and we provided this to the regulators in the north, the people who look at things like shipping and environmental assessment, and pat ourselves in the back. You know, you do all this theoretical work and you write your scientific papers, but here's one that we thought really contributed in a bigger picture to something that's really going to change policy, that might change how people do something like aligning new shipping lanes in the north to protect birds with climate change. So we were pretty proud of ourselves. And then we made the critical mistake of getting more data. And as a scientist, you never want to do that. You want to get data, write your paper, walk away, and never look again. No, of course, I'm kidding. We got more data, and as soon as we got more data, we started to realize the story is a lot more complex than we thought. In 2013, at the Big Sound Colony, you can see, top left, most of the foraging is within 100 kilometers, but some birds were going almost 200 kilometers away to Southampton Island to feed, which is really far. Tony Gaston is probably still the world expert on thick-billed MERS, and he was really surprised they were going 200 kilometers. In 2014, most of the foraging stays within about 100 kilometers of the colony, but in 2015, we've got some birds going 300 kilometers all the way over to the mainland, 300 kilometers one way to feed. If you'd have asked any of us before we tracked those birds, could they go 300 kilometers, we'd have all literally said, that's ridiculous, it's energetically crazy, they'd never do it, they would abandon their nest first. And yet here we have these birds actively breeding and coming back to the nest and flying 300 kilometers. So that was crazy. And then if you look at the bottom row compared to the top row, this is during incubation across the top row. When we go during chick rearing, more or less the birds fly not as far, generally about half as far to feed when they're having to come back and feed their chick. In the top, they're just feeding themselves and their partner's sitting on their egg. But now all of a sudden they've got to feed themselves and they've got another mouth to feed the chick. So they're making shorter, quicker trips. They're flying out and staying short. So our models that we developed, we know that there's annual variation we have to account for, and we know that there's seasonal variation that we have to account for. So we're back to tweaking those models to try and make them better now. But nonetheless, when we pull all of that data together, we've produced, this literally came out Monday, I think this paper came out Monday, we've produced what we think is the first, what I would call scientifically credible identification of key marine bird sites in the Canadian Arctic that's out there now for people to consider. So there's that ivory gull area way offshore here and some of the colonies with the different radiuses around the colonies that we've adjusted now, et cetera. If you add up the area in all the dark blue there, it's a little bit bigger than all of Germany or a little bit bigger than all of Norway. So it's not a small area at all. It's a big chunk of marine water in the Canadian Arctic that is really important for sustaining these seabirds. And we'll come back to that in a moment. We'll come back to that very shortly here. So that was great. We got that stuff together. But while we were starting to do this work, of course, globally, people are tracking all over the place in different species. And our colleagues in Antarctica put this paper out in 2015, I guess it was Raymond et al. And what they did is they took data from not only seabirds like we'd been doing, but they had data on whales and seals, and I think it's seabirds, whales, and seals, but all top predators in the marine system. They said, okay, it's interesting to just think about seabirds, but what about all the top predators? Can we look at the ocean and say, this area is really important for anything that's a predator or a top predator in the ocean? So they did a bunch of very fancy statistical work behind this and came up with these hot spots and cold spots around Antarctica, which are effectively predator biodiversity spots. And if it's a predator biodiversity spot, it's almost undoubtedly an overall biodiversity spot. You get generally lots of predators where you've got lots of food of different types. And so we decided we could do that too. And we had a postdoc, Marie-Auger Mette, who's now out at UBC, she's got a job out there, and David Yurkowski, two postdocs. I had data from about 13 species of seabirds from myself and colleagues, but we also were able to get data from, going on the bottom left of the images, the beluga, bowhead whale, Arctic char, Greenland sharks, Greenland halibut, polar bears, narwhal, all three types of seals that are common in the Arctic, and walrus. We put all that together, so we now have over 2,000 individuals we've tracked from 24 species, and we decided we would look at the first papers come out of multi-species hotspots in the Arctic. So here's the sort of distribution of the data we had. We had what we called three theaters. We had this western area where we thought good enough data to say something credible there, this Baffin-Davis area, and then the Hudson Bay area. And then there's some holes in here where we thought our data just weren't good enough, we didn't want to model in there. But we've done that, and that's just come out. And you can see here on the left image is the summer and autumn hotspots where it's red, and in the right image is the winter and spring hotspots. So they change quite a bit, obviously, because sea ice moves down in, and sea ice will cover most of this area here. So there's a few animals that stay there, but most move. But importantly, in the red are the hotspots, and in the purple are the protected areas that are existing or about to be made, marine protected areas in the Arctic. If you actually work out the overlap, there's only about 12% overlap. So even now with this big new Lancaster Sound National Marine Conservation Area that's about to come online this year, even with that, our protection of the marine waters in the Arctic only covers about what we think 12% of the important areas for our Arctic top predators. So we've got a lot of work to do if we still want to ensure the protection of some of these iconic species like some of the polar bears and seabirds. And I point out, I always like to have eggs in more than one basket, so it's nice to corroborate some of this stuff. So at the same time we were doing all this tracking stuff, I've been working closely with Environment Canada, Karina Gerdrum in Dartmouth, and I had a postdoc, Sarah Wong, and we were working at sea surveys. So I mentioned earlier that sailors and fishermen might see birds at sea. Well, you can actually go out and there's a protocol for doing this quantitatively, for getting good quantitative, statistically sound data on the distribution of birds at sea. It takes a little bit of sort of trigonometry in that to calculate angles and stuff to get your viewing. But basically, you're out there on a boat taking transects and counting birds in the transects. So we trained a bunch of students to do this. These are some of the students. There's Nick Knutson there, who went to UCNN, and he's doing a master's with Sean and I now. So we've trained students to go out on the ships. We get them on cruise ships. I know, it's a rough job. Someone's got to do it. But we get them on cruise ships. We get them on fisheries vessels. We get them on Coast Guard vessels. And they get up on the bridge, and basically their job while they're out there is counting birds in these transects. This is an example. We've got lots more data in this. But this is an example of some specific work we were doing around Baffin Island. And all these little lines you see are lines of ships where we've had seabird counts going on. And what we're able to generate with information like that are maps like this. So on the left, this is the density of northern fulmars, so just one species, northern fulmars in the summer. So we get these hot spots where we know fulmars are really numerous, and we get these cold spots like Hudson Bay where you don't have to worry about seeing fulmars, they're just not there. And on the right, this is the 2011 to 2015 shipping traffic in the Arctic. So we know the precise routes, and the hotter the color, the more ships. So we know the routes our ships are taking. We now can map with really good confidence the densities of birds so we can overlay those layers and identify the risk areas where there's a higher risk of ships interacting with birds. And then what we're right in the process doing now is adding that third layer from our tracking work to see how well our tracking work agrees with the ship-based surveys. So that's what I mean by corroboration. We're trying to tie those things together. And of course, now that I'm down here in the Maritimes, we're starting to do this in Atlantic Canada as well. I've just put some of our work here, not our colleagues. So on the top left, that's Isabeau doing work off of the Gannet Islands in Labrador on four different species, razorbills, thick-billed murres, common murres, and Atlantic puffins. At the top right, up here, this is terns, common terns, and Arctic terns at Country Island at the eastern shore. And this is Molly from some tracking work of common eiders here in the eastern shore and showing their high connectivity with eiders all breeding down along the coast of Maine. So we're starting to put these layers together here with our colleagues down in this area as well. And I've got one more example coming up to show that as well. So that gives you an idea of what we're doing when we're looking out from the colony, we're tracking these birds, and why are we doing it? One of the types of information we can get is where are these important sites, either very far away through the year, or where are they using around the colony? But there's lots of interesting stuff going on back at the colony as well, and that's actually what I started doing before the tracking technology came around. So we have all these birds going out, and they're feeding all over the area, and they're coming back and nesting at their colonies. What do you think happens when you put thousands of birds together for a few months? Well, the same thing happens when you put thousands of anything together for a few months. They have to do their business. So the birds are pooping basically everywhere back at their colonies, right? And depending on the type of bird, this can look different, whether it's like goose or some of the gulls look like this. Thick-billed murres really are kind of disgusting animals during the breeding season because you've got birds up above and they just stand there and they poop. And the poop goes down all over the birds below them. So you can see here's poop on the back of this bird here. And the kittiwakes just stand in their nest and turn around on the outside of their nest and poop over the side of the nest. So I've never claimed to be the smartest person around. I'll say that I'm not the smartest person in this room. I'm not even the smartest person in my own house. But I do know when to hire students. And I hire students the second that we start talking poop. That's a good time to get students involved. So on the left, that's Claudia, who's pulled this Atlantic puffin out of her burrow, and the puffin has given her a little present. And on the right, that's Daryl, who I had measuring eggs in at a Thayer's gull colony. He was actually quite mad that had happened to him. And with gulls, what actually happens is the intensity of how they defend their nest increases the closer they get to hatching. So when you first go by a gull nest early in the year, they sort of swoop at you and they try and fake you out and they dive. But as it gets really close to when the eggs are about to hatch, when they've got little chicks, they do that, but then they also start pooping on you as well. And terns do the same thing. So you know it's close to hatch when the poop starts raining down on you. So that's what these gulls do. This is one of my favorite photos. This is Josh Bodway with a Sabine's gull. Josh was banding its chick. The Sabine's gull wasn't happy, and if you look carefully, it scored a hole in one right in his ear. But it was a cold day, so Josh has a smile on. He's not too hurt there. And so this brings me to the second part of the work we do in the Arctic, at least with tracking and working with these seabird colonies. And that's this notion of biotransport, or what I call the Arctic conveyor belt, which is the birds fly out, they're feeding in the ocean, then they fly back like a conveyor belt, they come to land, and they're dumping a lot of the chemicals that they get in the ocean on land, like a conveyor belt bringing it in. Now, you could have an entire course on contaminants and movement to the Arctic. I'm going to condense it down into about 30 seconds here. The Arctic doesn't generate or have much pollution itself. There's next to nobody up there, certainly the Canadian Arctic. There's next to nobody up there. There's no real industry to speak of, etc. But it's very polluted in the Arctic. Why? Because pollutants move to the north through three ways. They move through the air on something called the grasshopper effect. So we get pollution that's released down in the tropics and in temperate areas like here. We either emit it out of our cars or factories, we spray it on our crops or lands, or it's just stuff that leaks around. If we think of something like an organic pollutant, like some sort of chemical you might spray, an insecticide you might spray on your lawn, when it gets really hot and the sun shines on that, some of that gets turned into gas and moves up into the atmosphere till it gets cold, catches in the rain, and the way that our winds move, they move that north and it falls, and then it heats up again, moves up, so it's like a grasshopper jumping north because of the way the winds move. They move it north till it finally gets to the Arctic and it doesn't get heated up again. So it lands in the Arctic and the Arctic is a sink. The pollution lands there and stays there. In a lot of places, it gets locked in glaciers or in permafrost. It gets in and frozen down. So it's actually archived there. So there's lots of pollution that's archived in the Arctic. But it can fall directly on the marine environment, directly in the ocean. It can fall on the land, especially on the snow. But then when that melts in the spring, it all goes into the rivers and then rushes into the ocean. Or it can move through ocean currents. So it can be already out in the ocean from anywhere and move up into the Arctic through ocean currents. So most of the pollution in the Arctic is coming and arriving by long-range transport. There are a few local point sources at military sites and old weather stations. So there are very local point sources, but it's minuscule compared to the long-range transport coming in. As a consequence of this, pretty much all Arctic wildlife carries contaminant burdens. From the tiniest spiders up to polar bears, you can measure contaminants in it, contaminants that have never been emitted or sprayed anywhere in the Arctic. You can still find those in these organisms in the Arctic. Often the contaminant levels in those organisms are higher than what we see down at these latitudes because of this process, because it's a sink. They're also high in marine food webs because in marine food webs, there's a lot of steps in a marine food web, so contaminants build to high levels. More so than, say, in a terrestrial food web. You can think of like a cow eating grass. The contaminant falls on the grass, the cow eats the grass, the cow gets the contaminant done. But if you just go into the marine environment, you've got the contaminant falls in, the plankton takes up the contaminant, which is eaten by a small zooplankton, then a bigger zooplankton, then a small fish, then a bigger fish, then maybe a bird, maybe the bird is eaten by another bird. So there's a lot of steps in the marine environment for these contaminants to build up and biomagnify. The trends differ by contaminant that we're talking about, but they're really tracked well by following seabirds. So seabirds are really good biomonitors for contaminants in the Arctic. So on this image here, I show two contaminants. These are ones that might be familiar to some people. They're phased out now pretty much in the world, but they were a big issue in the 1960s and 70s. PCBs,
which are carcinogenic, and DDT. DDT is from an environmental perspective, one of the worst contaminants that we've got experience with, because DDT, it was great for controlling mosquitoes and therefore great for reducing threats like malaria and that sort of thing. But it also built up in food chains and interfered with birds' ability to lay eggs. And so birds would lay eggs with very soft or no shells. And so the top predators like bald eagles and peregrine falcons, their populations absolutely crashed globally because of DDT. So a whole bunch of these types of contaminants were phased out. Regulations came in the 70s, and final phase out for some of these was around 2000. So the black line you see in these images, that's global emissions, the amount of PCBs or the amount of DDT that was emitted. And these other lines are us tracking the levels that we see in thick-billed MERS, northern fulmars, or black-legged kittiwakes. And you can see that with a little bit of lag time, after the emissions in the environment were reduced, fairly quickly, when we were looking at the birds, the levels in the birds also started to reduce. So this was a good news story that once we turn off the taps, once we stop polluting, it's quickly, in this case, fairly quickly, within a few years, it's starting to reduce the levels in the wildlife. Now, even though we're out, now we're kind of just at this flat line here for some of these contaminants, at least these two, where we're at background levels. The problem is a lot of these contaminants are persistent. They're built to last. They will be around for a long time, so there's always going to be some background level in the birds. And it sort of dishearteningly, now we think we're seeing a little bit of an uptick the last few years going on in the birds, and we think that's because climate change is melting those glaciers and permafrost that I said was archiving, that was freezing all those contaminants, the sink we're making up there. Now with the glaciers and permafrost melting, some of those are being re-released back into the environment. So we're seeing a little bit of an increase again in these contaminants. We're not going back to this sort of situation, but we're probably, another 5 years, we'll probably see this graph coming up a bit here like this because of this release from climate change. There's lots of other nasty things too. We've got dioxins and furans, diphenyl ethers, flame retardants, all sorts of chemicals. Pretty much any chemical you can think of that we use in tropical or temperate areas, any chemical you can think of, we now can detect in wildlife in the Arctic. Almost all of it makes it up there at some level, which is quite discouraging. Now, in contrast to DDT and PCB, which have been declining, mercury increased up until about the 2000s. We were seeing an increase in mercury in Arctic seabird eggs. Then it leveled out, and it may be starting to decline, although the last couple of years, again, look like they're going up a little bit. We now have a global agreement. Not everybody signed it, but the Minamata Convention was signed a couple of years ago. So we now have a global agreement to reduce mercury emissions. So we're hoping that over the next 50 years, this graph starts coming back down. Mercury occurs naturally in the environment, but it's very much elevated because of human activities, and it's a neurotoxin. And tests done in wildlife in the Arctic, be it polar bears or seabirds, have shown sublethal negative effects on wildlife, usually it's affecting reproduction, but sometimes it can affect visual acuity and brain function. So this is one that we want to see reduce as well. So just thinking about how we know we're tracking these birds, how is this process operating? We've got these birds that are going out over this entire area. They're going out over these thousands of square kilometers, and they're feeding on fish, squid, zooplankton, whatever they're eating at the surface. Those things are contaminated a bit at some level because the contaminants falling into the ocean. But we don't have to go out and collect each of those to see what's going on in the environment. The birds are doing that for us. Then they're bringing it back, and they're putting it in their egg, or they've got it in their own tissues. The birds are transporting it back to the colony for us, and then they're depositing it at the colony. They're depositing it because they're in feces, so they defecate. They drop bits of food, they throw up food, right? Sometimes they miss, the chick doesn't get it, and they die. Some birds, the chicks, the eggs, sometimes the birds die at the colony. So for all four of those ways, they're bringing back these nutrients and bringing back these contaminants to the colony and depositing these massive amounts of nutrients and contaminants in a very small area. So let's look at a couple of examples as what happens. So we'll go to Cape Vera, which is where we first did this and had sort of our biggest success doing this. Cape Vera is a fulmar colony, not that big, about 10,000 pairs, on Devon Island, very far north, about 76 degrees north. This is what Cape Vera looks like as you come in by helicopter. So we on the right, here's the ice cap. So these are glaciers back here, and we've got a little bit at the coast that's exposed. The birds are all nesting on these cliffs over on the right. And then because we've got a coastal foreland out front here, sort of a beach that extends up to about a kilometer away, and there's a bunch of freshwater ponds in front there. And so what happens is rain and snow falls against the bird colony, washes some of this material down, feces and other material, through the scree slope, and we expect that the ponds that are first receiving that material probably are quite polluted, and as we move farther away, the pond should be less polluted, depending on how the water moves through those ponds. So it's possible that you could have a pond here that if it doesn't receive much, it could be quite unpolluted, and the one beside it could be very polluted. But we knew how the water moved through this area. Just to give you an idea, we're down around here in Nova Scotia. The site we're talking about is right up here. So this was one of my first field sites in the Arctic. Now, to appreciate this, this is what some of the water looks like right below the cliffs. The ice only comes off of this in maybe the second week of July and forms again by about the third or the fourth week of August. So this is ice covered for almost 10 months of the year, and yet with that little short window when the ice is off, there's so many nutrients coming down into the colony that it's like a sewage lagoon. It's like an unregulated sewage lagoon you would see in a small community somewhere. So super, super rich, tons of algae growing. The algae becomes great food for various types of aquatic insects that like to feed on that. So you get a lot of aquatic insects, larvae, in these in this algae. It's very productive, despite the fact that we are that far north. So we took cores, you can see here in the center image, this core going down of these ponds down below. And when we first just looked at the surface sediments, the little bit at the top on those cores, we were able to see right away that the effect of these birds on those ponds. If you look at these graphs, if you move to the right on the graph, that's a higher influence of birds. We have a bunch of different ways of measuring that. Here we use stable isotopes, but we could do feather inputs or productivity, a whole bunch of different measures on how the bird influence was. And it's a logarithmic scale going up. So we're going up by orders of magnitude, very, very sharp graph. And you can see that ponds, so each of these dots represents a sample from a pond. Ponds that were really affected by the birds, had lots of bird input coming in, had very, very high levels of mercury, very high levels of DDT, and very high levels of chlorobenzene. Again, none of this stuff is from this area. It's all birds getting this by feeding in a polluted environment. And in fact, the DDT concentrations, those values we saw in DDT, was about the same concentration as you would see if you had sampled farm ponds when DDT was being applied in the 1960s. But this is happening 40 years after DDT has last been applied in Canada and thousands of kilometers from the nearest place that DDT would have been applied. So it just gives you an idea of how polluted our environment is, even in a place we think of as pristine like the Arctic, that you can get these crazy concentrations of DDT decades after it's last been used in this area. We can do the same thing here looking with arsenic, cadmium, and zinc. Arsenic and cadmium are non-essential items. We don't really want those in our body, so our body has ways of processing that. Zinc is essential, but if you get too much of it, like anything else, it can be toxic. Birds bioaccumulate this from their diet, and here what we see is bird, again, these sediments for colonies that were closest had the most influence of the birds nesting on the cliffs. We had extremely high levels of arsenic, cadmium, and zinc. So high, in fact, that they exceeded the Canadian sediment quality guidelines for the protection of aquatic life. These are the guidelines that we give to industry to make sure the effluent coming out of their factories is not too bad for the environment. And yet here the birds are exceeding those guidelines just by naturally feeding on what's in their environment. So again, it gives you an idea of this process of biotransport and biomagnification can generate really high levels of contaminants even in a natural situation in a very remote site. We can also go back here and we can date. We can go down those cores, so instead of just looking at the top of the core, we can actually date the core going down and look when the contaminants started to arrive, and we can look at other sort of proxies in there for how it affected the productivity of the ponds, when they started to change, how it compared to a pond that isn't affected by birds, etc. So we can do all sorts of stuff with these cores and get a history of the influence of birds on this area. Importantly, when we look at everything in the area, so if we sampled, well, we did sample everything. We sampled plants, we sampled eggs, we sampled snow buntings, we sampled foxes, ermine or weasels. When we sample all the terrestrial biota in the environment, we find out that at the colony, there's a real relationship at the colony between a greater influence of seabirds. Again, if we're going to the right here, you can use this particular chemical metric as an influence of seabirds and having a lot higher levels, in this case, of DDT. So the snow buntings, which feed on seeds in the winter and feed on bugs up there in the summer, the snow buntings at Cape Vera are probably the highest concentration of breeding buntings in the world, 35 pairs per square kilometer, crazy high. But they're also, of six studies that we know, they're also the most contaminated snow buntings in the world, even though they're nowhere near a contaminant source. But the levels of DDT in snow buntings are higher than an Arctic fox and higher than an ermine at the site even, because the buntings are feeding directly on all those little aquatic insects that are emerging out of the ponds and living in those contaminated sediments. Now, it's also nice to collaborate with people who work sort of in slightly different disciplines than I do. So one of the things that we've been doing most recently is looking at some new chemical tools, because one of the things I was interested in is, can we use these different chemicals to try and tell how much the bird population has changed through time? So we can use these stanols and sterols, these naturally occurring organic molecules that are produced by all living organisms. We get a fairly high concentration of cytosterol coming out of plants. For humans, we get this one called epicoprostenol, which basically comes out in our feces, but humans produce that. And cholesterol, lots of us produce that, but certainly when you've got a bird colony, you get a lot of cholesterol from the bird colony. And we can go down those cores and we can look at the ratio of these different stanols and sterols in the cores. And now we can start to do things like look at the core and say, oh, we had a huge shift in whatever year from cytosterol to now cholesterol. That means that's when the bird colony started at that site. Because all of a sudden now we've got all this cholesterol coming in. So we can now date when birds actually started nesting at sites. And at some of these cores, we've got two cores where we had this spike in epicoprostenol, and then it disappeared a couple hundred years later, which just happened to be the two sites where we had Norse and Thule remains by the ponds. So this was a site where ancient Inuit and Vikings both were in at this site, and we can now date when they were actually at the site, probably exploiting the birds at the colony. So it's kind of neat when you have these cores and you're working with people who do some other fun things, and you can get some other types of information out of them. And to show that this effect is worldwide, again, bringing it back here to Nova Scotia, one of the first projects I did related to this when I moved back to Nova Scotia was to the eastern shore. There's lots of islands along the eastern shore. Lots of them have bird colonies, lots of them don't. So we had an undergraduate project for Lewis and working with Molly and Amy here. And we went out and we sampled soils in all of these, and we were able to quickly show that we could distinguish islands that had bird colonies or recent bird colonies from islands that had never had bird colonies quite easily simply by sampling the soil, because of these bioaccumulated elements that the birds bring and then dump back there through all those different methods. So we can simply go along, sample the soil, and tell you which islands have or had bird colonies because of this contamination biotransport. And one that might be a little closer to home here, right here now, I've got a master's student who's working on a broad project we've got on the effects of the mink farms in this area, the broad environmental footprint of the mink farms. So the mink farms are situated around here, and we've got fish factories all along here. We've got birds from Briar Island, so the gull colonies of Briar Island coming in to feed at the mink farms. We've got birds that are nesting as far away out as Kent Island in the middle of the Bay of Fundy are flying across to come feed at the mink farms, and up at Bear Island by Digby coming down to feed at the mink farms. And what we're doing now is testing the soils back at these colonies to see if we can distinguish chemicals that they've picked up from the mink farms and they're now taking back and depositing back at colonies around the south shore and out into the Bay of Fundy. So it's a biotransport project that Jesse is working on now right down in this area. So I point out that while all of this stuff is exciting scientifically, as a scientist, you're hoping you get good discoveries, you're hoping you produce papers, it's a bit disheartening as an environmentalist, which I think I'm an environmentalist and conservationist first, but most of this work, especially because I work closely with a lot of government collaborators, most of this work goes directly into policy and directly into negotiating documents. For example, when we go to Japan and Canada has its position on negotiating international mercury regulations, our data from Prince Leopold Island is one of those data sets and some of those figures that go right into the Canadian document to say, hey, here's the problem. And the same thing with all those persistent organic pollutants and other chemicals. So it is we do know that what we're doing is making a difference. It's not just for self-interest and being able to get a paper out. So I take some heart in that, given that it's kind of depressing that such a remote and beautiful, pristine place is actually quite polluted. So finally, just to summarize, looking out and looking in, we started by talking out here, top left, about where birds nest in the Canadian Arctic and the fact that you tend to get a few big colonies separated along principally eastern Canadian Arctic, and we get lots of these birds together. And then a lot of our work looks at where the birds are using in the marine environment. So we use different types of tracking technologies to be able to look and say, where are they going? What's the important marine area? And we've started to put those data together now to be able to map important sites in the Canadian Arctic and elsewhere. Then we shifted gears and started talking about these birds all coming back to the colony and defecating and dropping bits of food and bringing pollutants and nutrients, but pollutants back to the colony, and showing that at a lot of these colonies in the Canadian Arctic now, they are effectively like little point source pollution sites. They're almost like little factories in that all of the birds coming there feeding on contaminated marine food webs means that it's a sort of a contaminated ring around these seabird colonies, to the point where they look like little oases because you've got all these nutrients there. There's so few nutrients in the Arctic that when you're bringing back all this nitrogen and phosphorus from dead fish and feces, lots of plants grow. It looks really lush. It attracts lots of birds. You get lots of flowering plants, so it looks like a little oasis, but it's a pretty contaminated oasis. And so really what we have is we've got what I call these reciprocal effects. The environment or the landscape dictates where the birds can nest. And so the birds come in and nest at those areas, and then in turn, by moving in there and living there, they alter the landscape that they're nesting on, certainly for themselves, but for other organisms that nest around there. That's the end of this craptastic talk, and I will be happy to take any questions. Thank you very much.
Dr. Mellor. Pour les questions, s'il vous plaît, si vous entendez qu'il y a des questions qui étaient déjà posées, essayez de poser d'autres questions parce que nous avons une période assez courte là, pour couvrir la majorité de vos questions. Alors, Sean va être là. Si vous avez des questions, il pourra les traduire ou si vous le posez exactement en anglais. Merci.
Okay, so we can take questions in English as well, if you want, and we'll translate them back to Mark and back. So English or French, anglais, français, c'est, ça fait pas de différence, on va traduire.
Thank you, Mark. So I'm just wondering, how do the birds cope with having those little weights attached to their feet?
Right, so the question is, how do the birds cope with the weight on their feet? What we do is, through animal care regulations, they found that you have to keep the attachments less than 3% of the body weight. If you go over 3% of the body weight, you clearly have a lot, not all birds, but a lot of birds have negative behavioral effects. If it's under 3% of body weight, most birds do fine, so they return the nest, they survive, obviously, they return to nest. There still are some small differences, but they're fairly minimized. So that's been a change that came from about the last 10 years. Prior to that, people were doing 5% body weight, occasionally even larger, and you were having a lot of birds that either died or just didn't return, and we don't know what happened to them. So there's obviously, it's like if you put on a watch or you put on a new piece of jewelry, you know, for the first few days, you're gonna notice it's there and you play with it and that, and then after a while, we think that they kind of get used to it after a while.
I'm just going to quickly say that in French. Alors, la question, c'était, tous ces oiseaux qui portent des émetteurs sur leurs pattes ou sur leur dos, quelles sont les conséquences potentielles aux oiseaux? Et est-ce qu'il y a une certaine masse qu'il faut respecter? Et c'est plus ou moins écrit que typiquement, tu ne vas pas mettre quelque chose sur l'oiseau qui pèse plus que 3 % de la masse corporelle. C'est Marc, quand lui avait commencé la recherche, le monde allait des fois à 5, 6 %, mais typiquement, on essaie de le garder à moins de 3 %. Et pour avoir le permis de faire quelque chose comme Marc vient de faire, ou les émetteurs qu'on met sur l'ignital ici sur le campus, il faut qu'on passe l'approbation d'un comité de protection des animaux. Et en fait, Acadia puis Sainte-Anne, on a un comité qui travaille ensemble justement pour évaluer des protocoles. Dr. Ted Layton de Sainte-Anne est sur ce comité aussi. Donc, c'est assez rigoureux pour être capable de faire de quoi avec un animal. C'est juste pas n'importe qui pourrait mettre quelque chose sur un oiseau ou un autre animal.
Est-ce qu'il y a une réelle relation entre la taille ou le nombre de colonies et la quantité de contaminants qu'on trouve à la surface du sol?
So, have you found the relationships between the size or maybe the density of a population of seabirds and contaminant loads?
Great question. No, not yet. We get more of a correlation between the species at a colony and the contamination in the soil. So, for example, you could have a really large colony of thick-billed MERS, which generally are large colonies, but because they don't feed as high in the food web, say, as glaucus gulls, for example, if you sample the soil around a glaucus gull nest, you'll get higher concentrations of contaminants than you will if you sample where the MERS are. But saying all of that, this is still the whole examination of soils and the movement back to the surface is still really in its infancy. It's only been going on with soils for about 5 years now, maybe 10, but the papers have really just started coming out the last 5. So there's been some great work done in Antarctica with penguins as well, where they're showing differences between different penguin colonies and types of contaminants. But it's, right now, it's highly variable. All that we can say is that for a bird that feeds very high in the food web, you tend to get higher concentrations of contaminants around its colony, but there's a lot of variation.
Oui. Alors, de façon générale, ça dépend de l'espèce, où l'espèce se situe sur la chaîne alimentaire ou spécifiquement dans le réseau trophique. Alors, les animaux qui se nourrissent plus haut, donc les prédateurs, les grands prédateurs des systèmes vont accumuler ou bien accumuler plus de toxines au cours du temps. Et donc, c'est plus eux qui ont plus de toxines. Donc, ce n'est pas nécessairement relié à la concentration de nombre d'individus dans la colonie. C'est plutôt une question de l'espèce. Oui, bonne question.
Mark, you gave us data about some of the old pollutants of the 50s and 60s, the PCBs and DDT, and it was nice to see how those have gone down. But in the 21st century, are we seeing new persistent kinds of pollutants also concentrating into the Arctic? Is there a modern version of those curves, so to speak, that might be less, more disquieting, let's put it that way.
Do you want to translate first? Or?
Go ahead.
Do you want to translate the question or just let me answer?
Go ahead and answer and then I'll.
Okay. Yeah, Ted, so we are. So we actually just had a paper come out last week on different types of plasticizers and UV chemicals that are put in plastic to minimize the ability of plastic to be affected by UV radiation. So these are chemicals that are produced and put in all sorts of plastics, and we found them now in Arctic wildlife for the first time. But that's just in recent samples, so what we haven't done is gone back in time now to see when, we haven't analyzed the old archived eggs yet, we just now have been able to show for the first time that they're there and they're passed on from mother to eggs, so we're getting them in the eggs and in the livers of adults. So these are new, for example, we don't know, but we think that these are coming from birds ingesting plastic, digesting plastic that's now in the Arctic, and as they digest the plastic, some of the chemicals from the plastic are coming out into their system. So that's what we think is going on. So we would predict that there probably wasn't a lot of plastic in the Arctic in the 70s, 80s, maybe not even until the early mid-90s. So when we go back and look 10,
test some of those out in schools, and if we get nothing in a bunch of those, we might start picking it up in the 2000s. So you're right. New chemical, brominated flame retardants are increasing.
Alors, c'est une bonne question. C'était par rapport à est-ce qu'il y a d'autres contaminants qui n'étaient peut-être pas nécessairement présents dans l'environnement il y a quelques décennies, comme on a vu le DDT et d'autres qui étaient présents. Et donc, Dr. Mallory avait indiqué que oui, il y en a des nouveaux types de toxines. Et une qui devient de plus en plus commune, c'est des produits chimiques associés au plastique. Et tout le monde a probablement vu des images de plastique peut-être dans des estomacs d'albatros ou d'autres espèces, et on est en train de trouver de plus en plus, par exemple, dans des œufs, dans les transferts entre parents et leurs jeunes, des produits chimiques associés avec la fabrication de plastique.
Thank you for your presentation. You talked a little bit how some of the species you study were endangered species. I can't remember them off the top of my head, but with those colonies, do you see more that they are more spread out in smaller groups, or are they? Is it more like one big colony where the endangered species all hangs out in one colony?
Okay, so the two endangered species we work with are ivory gulls and Ross's gulls. Ross's gulls are super rare. And so we know, like, when we find a colony, we only know of about 4 or 5 colony sites in the Canadian Arctic, and we only get to one of those almost every year. And then, but they are spread out in the sense that there's colonies separated by hundreds of kilometers, but they're super small colonies, like a pair or two pairs of birds. They're very, very rare. Ivory gulls are spread out over a good chunk in the Canadian Arctic, and the colonies are typically 20 birds, or less in a lot of the areas, and then you get a few large colonies of about 100 pairs. So they're spread out, but with the ivory gull, here and in Russia, all of the colonies at the southern edge of the range are disappearing. So that, we are pretty sure, is a climate change signal that ivory gulls used to nest farther south, and now all of those colonies at the southern edge of the range, we don't get birds anymore. So they are spread out, but they are disappearing in some areas that we would predict exactly where we would think they'd be disappearing.
La question était plutôt par rapport à les deux espèces qui sont menacées, une qui est en voie de disparition, des mouettes, et c'est quoi la situation de ces colonies. Ça a l'air que les changements climatiques ont un impact sur possiblement le nombre d'individus et le déclin, mais de façon générale, les deux espèces, les colonies sont assez larges au niveau de leur distribution, puis il y a juste quelques individus qui nichent dans chaque colonie. On parle de juste quelques individus pour chaque espèce.
I've got a question. Oh, no, Ben.
You mentioned that some kind of seabirds follow the polar bear, and they feed on what the kill of the... Now we know that there's the ice melting in the Arctic, and those polar bears having difficulties finding their food, killing seals. So is this affecting the colony of those seabirds?
Yeah, great question. That's the ivory gull again. We refer to, those of us who work on it, we just call the ivory gull as just a feathered polar bear. They're tiny, but they follow polar bears. They live on ice like polar bears. They eat the same stuff polar bears eat because they eat what polar bears kill. So they're kind of like a feathered polar bear. So almost all of the problems you've heard with polar bears are going on with ivory gulls. The difference, of course, is that ivory gulls aren't hunted like polar bears, and they don't move around as much, and they're certainly not as in the eye of the public as polar bears, so we know less about them because there's not as much research done on them. But yeah, most of those things, we think the chemical problems that polar bears have, being at the top of the food chain, is going on in ivory gulls, and polar bears are having real problems at the warm parts of the range, in the Beaufort Sea and in Western Hudson Bay, the two hottest areas, that's where we're having the most problems. And in the same sort of idea, the southern parts of the range, the ivory gull is where they're having the most problems. So yeah, we're seeing very analogous problems going on with the two species. Yeah.
My students have to leave here, I guess.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Malone.
Si vous avez d'autres questions, on va juste attendre que les étudiants qui ont un cours qui commence à 3 heures quittent la salle, puis on peut continuer pour quelques autres minutes si vous avez des questions. Some students have to leave for class for 3, but we can hang around for a few more minutes if you have questions for Dr. Mallory. So we'll just wait a minute or so. Okay, est-ce qu'il y a d'autres questions? Are there other questions?
I was just wondering, between the geolike locators, the GPS packs, and the radio transmitters, how do they compare in the field as far as the time length, like the lifespan of them goes?
Okay, so the satellite transmitters that have a solar panel on the back can go a long time. So I had one Ivory Gull that we tracked for 6 or 7 years, I think, with that one on its back. But lots of the times, I think that they're tied on with a Teflon tape harness that doesn't wear on the feathers. But I think after a while, after a couple of years, normally 2 or 3 years, there's enough wear on the harness that it breaks. It depends. You can set the harness up to only last a year, and then it has a spot in it that will purposely break. So some people do that if they only want a year of data. The geolocators. Will last forever. The life of the bird. I mean, we've recovered geolocators at Labrador that were put out like 6 or 7 years earlier. But the thing is, the battery inside wears out after a while, so it'll still keep the data in there, but it will have stopped recording data long before you recover it. And the GPS ones now have a solar panel on the back. So the ones that we put out at Bear Island, the birds have gone away. They've got a solar panel on the back. And the limitation with those is because GPS takes such an incredible number of measurements on the bird that you have to decrease how frequently it takes the measurement of the bird, or else it fills up all the memory in the transmitter quickly. So if you were to decrease the frequency, if you didn't want to know, like in the summer, the maps that I showed there for the mink site, that's taking a position every 15 seconds, I think, or 1 minute. If you want to just have a position 2 times a day, then that, and you've got sunlight, you know, that in theory could run 2 or 3 or 4 years. So geolocators, you'll only get about most geolocators that I'm aware of, a maximum of about 2 years worth of data, and then they run out of battery. And the others, if they're solar powered, can go a lot longer, multiple years. But typically most studies get data for about a year and a bit, and then inevitably something happens. Sometimes the bird dies. Often, I think the bird figures out a way finally to shed the harness. Those are the main things. Yeah.
Est-ce qu'il faut traduire en français? Is everybody okay with the English? Okay, John.
I'm just curious with the birds that are when they're incubating and they're fighting. Flying quite a long distance, have you looked at all whether they're getting any flight assistance in terms of following prevailing winds?
That's a good question. Yes. So if the birds are, I'll answer that two ways. First off, we know for sure using the geolocators with some of the species like Arctic terns, for example. Clearly, when they start their migration north, for example, coming from Antarctica. they move across to South America to pick up the winds that blow them back across the Atlantic and get wind-aided on their way north to get back up to Greenland. Probably our birds in the Canadian High Arctic follow that same route. So they definitely get wind assists on the annual wind patterns when they're going right across the globe. For local movements of birds, yes. What you see are, there's things called accelerometers that you can put inside these transmitters as well. So they give you lots of information on the angle and the pitch and movement of the bird. And you can see the bird adjusting. And Kyle Elliott at McGill has been doing a lot of this work. You can see the bird adjusting to flight, to prevailing wind directions. And probably, I mean, of course, we can't be in the bird's head ahead of time, but I wouldn't be at all surprised. I haven't seen Kyle's data yet, but I wouldn't be at all surprised if you had a day where you saw the birds were going over here to feed and strong winds came up, there were crosswinds, you would probably see the birds start to shift off and go with the prevailing winds to reduce energy costs flying into that wind and go and feed in a new area. I'm sure that happens, I'm just not familiar with the papers. But yeah, we've got these things called accelerometers that give us that now. The technology for what we can do with following wildlife now is incredible. And I have to admit, just to be brutally honest, in a way it makes me a little bit sad because some of the secrets that they have, they don't have anymore. You know what I mean? Because we get these insights into what they're doing, where they're going, and what they're doing, and now they've got these tiny cameras. So we've got cameras. Kyle's put some of those out on MERS at Dig Sound, and the Japanese chaps have put them out on albatrosses. And, I mean, it's phenomenal. It's just wonderful to see. But by the same token, it's like, oh, there's one more thing that's not a secret anymore for that wildlife species. Right now, we know what it's doing. So, I mean, a little part of me misses the mystery.
Features of the birds is changing, or color, or size of eggs, or something. Is there any, because so many contaminants these days, so I just wonder.
So do we have any evidence that contaminants are changing the eggs, like the color or the size?
Of the color or size, the birds, and the eggs.
We've, well, if I understand the question correctly, there's evidence that, so again, I'll answer two parts. We have evidence that climate influences bird egg size. So in years when the sea ice, at least in the high Arctic, in years when sea ice is really heavy and late, which happens naturally in nature, it's not just from climate change, then some birds don't nest because the conditions are too bad, and birds that do nest tend to lay smaller eggs. When it's an early year, and that's going to change in the future to earlier years for a while, then birds often lay earlier and they lay bigger eggs. So we know that. In terms of contaminants, there are studies that show, for example, with mercury, that birds that eat more mercury, get more mercury in the diet, lay smaller eggs. So we do know those. That's in dovekies, for example. In terms of knowing that a contaminant is related to changes in egg color, I don't know about that for seabirds. There's other bird species that they've shown that the modeling and the color can be influenced. Usually it's an indication of the health of the bird, and so somehow if the bird is laying an egg that doesn't look right, often it means the bird's the energy the bird have is being compromised because it's having to use energy to do too many things instead of just focusing on laying an egg. So there are some studies, but I'm not aware of those in seabirds. But there are on some other species. Yeah.
Certainly, some of the colony, the seabird difference. How many birds do you have to study to be able to say, well, this is really an established fact? How many birds do you have to, you know, to tag or put a transmitter on?
Okay, that's a really great question coming from someone with a math background. So there actually was a bunch of folks in the UK looked at that about probably about 5 years ago now, and were able to show that there'd been enough tracking studies. So we would, still to this day, but for a long time, what we would do is we'd say, we need to put out 25 transmitters because we expect that we're going to lose five, the birds will abandon, we won't get them, and then maybe another five won't function very well because the transmitters, it's touchy technology. So now you're down to 15, and if 15 of those, you know, natural things happen, predators take eggs and stuff, so you might put out 25 in the hopes you get 12 good tracks that provide enough data for you to say something. But these guys looked at looked at all of these big studies, and they were able to, what they were really interested in is how many birds do we need to track to be able to define what is the important area for that colony to feed in. And they showed that for most studies, we didn't need as many as we thought. That there's individual variation amongst the birds, but, and I, it varies by species and their foraging style, but lots of the colonies, you could do well less than 20 transmitters and have basically, in most years, the entire foraging area for that colony mapped out with less than 20 transmitters. And for a lot of the bird species, if you're working on gulls, for example, or some other species that if they don't dive or they're very predictable coming back, there's transmitters called I Got You transmitters that are $100. They're only $100. You can put those on the bird, put 20 of those out, and you can figure out the colony foraging range. It doesn't work for diving birds and stuff, but what they're made for, these transmitters are made for putting on your running shoe. And then you put them on your running shoe, and then you can download them when you get home and see where you went and put it on a map. And there's another group in France that built these ones called cat tracks, because in France people let cats out of their houses, so they wanted to know where the cats were going and hunting in the city, so they put it on the collar. And scientists said, well, that's cheap, let's use it on birds. And so they've done that with birds. So you could, for 20, like, so for $2,000, if you're working in the right species, you could map the foraging range of that colony. Unfortunately, we can't do that in the Arctic, but.
Mark, I'm looking at the puffin and thinking about all the changes to the temperature of the seawater, especially in the Gulf of Maine, where we're seeing temperature rises, greater than most places
yep.
in the planet, and we're starting to see some of the consequences of that warmer water. Bingo with that species, and which prefers herring, and Tony Diamond and their team over Machias found that the herring are sinking down now to colder waters just because it's too warm on the surface, and so now the Atlantic puffins are going for second, third, fourth best, and it's having consequences. Can we anticipate similar things in the Arctic, or maybe we're already seeing similar effects?
So yes, we can anticipate similar things. At that Coates Island study, we saw from when Tony started in 82 until, well, now it's still Kyle Elliott's still working there. For the first 15 or so years, or at least 10 years that Tony worked there, the main dietary item in thick-billed MERS diet was Arctic cod. Arctic cod are a small fish, very fatty, and a lot of the good fats, Arctic fats that don't congeal when they get too cold, so it's unsaturated fats, I guess. And per gram of fish, they contain a lot of energy, so they were great for thick-billed MERS because they're a lot of energy packet. And they associate under the sea ice, so MERS would go down and underneath the sea ice and could find them foraging in the bottom of the sea ice. Now, it actually started around 1990, there was a period when we were monitoring for about 5 years where one year, so the other competitor was capelin. They would also get capelin there, which are not quite as energy dense, and they're a cool water fish, not a cold water fish. So it would be dominated. 80% of the diet was Arctic cod, 20% was capelin and other fish. From 1990 to about 94, it started being in this state of flux where it was almost 50-50, or in some years they'd be more capelin. And then ever since about 1994, 95, it's been dominated by capelin to the point now where it's 80% capelin in the diet. So we've seen this shift where the ice is going out now 3 weeks earlier in Hudson Bay than it did even in the 1990s. So ice is going out 3 weeks earlier. We've had a total shift in there of a cool water replacing a cold water species. So we've got a cool water species there now. And parents were in poor body condition because they were having to work harder to get as much energy to feed their chicks, because each fish, they only bring back one fish at a time, and each fish they're bringing back has proportionally less energy in it. So chick growth weights were reduced, and parental body condition was reduced. Now, some birds have the behavioral plasticity to be able to compensate for that, but lots don't. And so the long-term projection from that is that, first off, thick-billed MERS over decades or centuries are going to decline at the colony, but there's lots of capelin around, so things that are capelin specialists, like razorbills, probably will invade there. So there probably will still be a seabird colony there. It's just we're going to see a shift, a move up of seabirds that are more typical of Atlantic waters into the Arctic. And we've already seen some razorbills there in years with high capelin. So so it's a little different than the state here. There might not be a replacement here. If puffins have a hard time, they go. And certainly I showed that shot of Isabel there. There were a couple weird years there when Isabel was working. The puffins were just feeding on fish larvae. They couldn't get what they wanted. It was just fish larvae, so they had a terrible breeding season. In the Arctic, because it's limited, there's not a lot of diversity, and it's you know, at one end of the extreme, very cold, limited now. So there's room for lots of different species to move up there, and so we expect that to happen. You know, razorbills, you know, within the next, say, 500 years, razorbills up there, common murres probably moving farther north, maybe even things like leeches, storm petrels. And if the ice ameliorates enough, some of those 30 million dovekies that are over on the Greenland side, where they have open water all year, the Canadian side is ice covered. Once that Canadian side stops being ice covered all year, we should certainly see dovekies nesting on our side. So we should see some invasions from species that are adapted to slightly warmer conditions. That's what I would expect.
So as you just mentioned, the reduced ice cover over a longer period of time in the year is going to impact, I assume, the amount of shipping that's going to be going through those areas. So from your understanding of the ecologic situation and the discussions that are happening at a policy level, what do you see as going to be the impact of the increased shipping, and how is your data going to be used to inform those policies?
Great. So in terms of how our data are going to be used, I'll answer the second part first. Our data is already, because we do a lot of collaboration with, excuse me, with government scientists, they're kind of connected to the people who need to know right away, and they actually fund a lot of our work, but it's a long story. I have the beautiful advantage of having been in the government for 20 years, so I know a lot of the players still who survived, who haven't retired yet. So I still have quite a few connections there at various levels, so that's great. So our data gets into those people who need to know, and there are some good, keen policy people who want to be up on the most current information. And we work very closely with Fisheries and Oceans. So now it's really a joint sort of effort between the marine mammal particular and seabird people to get this type of information in. So our information gets into environmental assessment work, these strategic, and we're involved in a big one now, strategic environmental assessment for Baffin Bay. All of our data is going in that for the risk of oil spills, what this could mean, oil spill modeling, blah, blah, blah. All of our tracking works in that, which is wonderful. In terms of what I think it's going to be for policy, I think that was the first part of your question. It depends who's in power and depends who really has the final say. And the reason I say that is that Inuit in the north are still... they're kind of caught in the middle because they're tremendously in need of economic development in the north. They need economic development. There's very few options for them up there. Increased shipping, mining, low-level sustainable ecotourism, those are some, and fishing. Those are really the options, right? You can't do forestry and agriculture. So they're going to need some of this. By the same token, they probably more than any other group that I've encountered in Canada are unbelievably committed to trying to maintain or protect their environment as much as they can. And they're in a situation where other than these contaminants that have gotten up there, their environment is relatively pristine compared or relatively natural compared to anywhere else in Canada. So I think as we go forward, and especially with after the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, after some of the efforts that the federal government in particular have made to acknowledge and properly engage Indigenous peoples, in this case Inuit, in these processes, I think you will see things that in the past may have moved a little bit more quickly to facilitate industry. I think they might move a little bit more slowly, but will be more environmentally sustainable or at least better in the north because Inuit will demand it. The second, and irrespective of whether Inuit are there or not, the second huge issue for Canada, of course, is that all of the world except Canada views the Northwest Passage as international waters. We call it internal waters. And the first time some ship tries to go through there and has an oil spill, then we'll see whose waters it is. Because if a Venezuelan ship goes through and they have an oil spill, I highly doubt Venezuela is going to send ships up to clean it up. It's going to be us, right? And so I think once one of those accidents, like a lot of us who've worked up there on these, whether you're working on trying to save wildlife, or whether you're simply just working with Inuit and communities and figuring out what's going to happen going through some of these scenarios, we haven't hit one of those yet. But the first time we have one of those, when some international body causes catastrophic pollution in what we all call Canadian waters, and in their Canadian waters in the winter, because when that area is frozen, that's Inuit highway moving between communities. It's all skidoo tracks. So you know, I think the first time that something like that happens, then I think you're going to see policymakers have a very large hammer that they can take to play. Right now, until that happens, I think the world is just quite content to say, oh, if we need to go through, but let's not give in to Canada. That's my personal opinion, of course. Does that help? Okay.
All right, well, I think we'll wrap it up there. If anybody has any other questions, maybe Mark can hang around for
sure.
for a couple minutes. Just before we go, we just have a little something for Mark for taking the day to come down here and visit us. So thanks so much, Mark, for coming down.
Thank you. It's a new puppy. Thank you very much.